Dartmouth in South Devon is a very ancient and pretty town, lying at the mouth of the River Dart, a spectacular deep water estuary that can provide anchorage for up to 600 ships. It's one of the great historic small towns of England, in an area of outstanding natural beauty, little changed over the centuries. On the opposite bank of the river is the hamlet of Kingswear. The surrounding area is dotted with ancient, picturesque villages. The coastal scenery is superb. All is steeped in history. In 1147 and 1190, Crusaders departed from here for the Holy Land. Dartmouth always had a railway station, but with the peculiarity that it never had a railway. In the golden age of steam, people would arrive at Kingswear and ferry across the river. This is still done. Other methods of arrival are by private yacht, coach or car. A unique oddity is the town centre, known as the boat float, a parking area for small boats entered through a short waterway from the river. It is very unwise, having imbibed scrumpy, otherwise local cider from the barrel, to negotiate this area, especially at night. For hundreds of years, it's been no stranger to collecting victims. On an opposite corner is the railway station that never was, now a restaurant. Hours can be spent watching the never-ending activity on the River Dart. Another peculiarity is that the bed of the river, not the river itself, is the property of Prince Charles, Duke of Cornwall, through the Duchy of Cornwall. What one can do with just the bed of the river when the river itself is not owned as well is puzzling. One of those typical English eccentricities. Gardens situated next to the boat float are a quiet haven of peace, giving time for pleasant reflection, conversation, and music practice, perhaps. A boulevard cafe provides sustenance al fresco. It's notable that cleanliness is paramount. Residents and visitors are required to keep it so. The authority ensures the frequent emptying of litter bins. But a quick sniff is surely inadvisable. The ancient buildings require maintenance from time to time. A little sad that this has to be accomplished noisily. As in many ancient towns in England, Dartmouth has its medieval rows with small and interesting shops. The town is built on a very steep hillside with narrow streets. There are many ancient classical buildings, medieval houses and old quays. unchangeable and untouchable. Pedestrian access to some residential parts of the town requires a degree of fitness and patience. This pub below the steps, unchanged, has been serving ale and cider for about 650 years.
Could you get me that ticket that's on it? Yeah. I've got nothing in the till. That's that.
The river, for about a mile upstream, is a deep water anchorage capable, even at low tide, of receiving Royal Naval ships up to destroyer size. These ships arrive from time to time to anchor below the Royal Naval College. Across the river, Kingswear is mostly built alongside the main street. The railway station is the end of the line from Torquay and Paignton, and has been since 1864. Travellers then cross to Dartmouth by ferry. The road also ends here, so vehicular traffic crosses to Dartmouth by the lower pontoon ferry. Ferries have operated in one form or another for hundreds of years, motor vehicles being preceded by horses and horse-drawn traffic. The only bridge crossing of the river is 12 miles upstream at Totnes. The ferries save a road journey of up to 30 miles. Boat activity on the River Dart maintains a pace during daylight hours throughout the year. The tide race is powerful, swift and dangerous, making good navigational knowledge essential. The upper vehicle ferry. It has plied in its present form for over 100 years. The pontoon is not steerable. It picks up and follows an anchored cable which lies on the riverbed. At the eastern end of Dartmouth is Bayard's Cove. It is little known, but it was from here that the Pilgrim Fathers actually boarded the Mayflower and the Speedwell in 1620 for their journey to America. The Speedwell sprang leaks, so they put into Plymouth for repairs. The rest is history. At the end of the quay at Bayard's Cove is a gun fort built in 1534 by the merchants and townsmen as a further line of defence to guard against enemy ships from France and Spain. Dartmouth has always been strategically important. At the entrance to the river, Dartmouth Castle, well over 600 years old, is diagonally opposite Kingswear Castle and Gomeroch Tower. In Henry VIII's reign, a thick hawser was slung below water between the two castles. If unwelcome ships arrived, the hawser was raised, stopping the ships dead. This was replaced by a metal chain. In World War II, anti-submarine nets were added and fixed between the two castles. Below Dartmouth Castle lies historic Castle Cove. The Gun Tower, built from 1481, was the first of its kind in Britain. The guns occupied not only the roof, but several floors known as casemates. A problem here was the smoke and fumes. Guns were first installed in 1388, aimed and firing across and down into the river. No ship would continue to live, especially if held by the raised rope or chain. Behind the castle lies Wharfleet Creek. From Elizabethan times, this was used to beach wooden ships. When the tide went out, the crews were able to careen the hulls. Slapton Beach. In 1944, the people left so that the American forces could practice for the D-Day landings. The pebbly beach shelves sharply into very deep water. Even on calm days, the sea is often rough with a strong undertow. Command made a gross error. Sherman tanks were loaded onto landing craft. Many capsized, drowning the men trapped inside. 954 men met this terrible fate. This Sherman tank was raised from the seabed 40 years later in 1984 and forms the central point of a memorial to the men. A remembrance service is held annually. An obelisk records the sacrifices made by the local communities who left their homes and property so that the military could use the area. Today it is again a hard-working, mainly farming community. The freshwater lake behind the beach is a peaceful haven for wildlife. Hope Cove is 21 road miles from Dartmouth. It has a very safe, fine, sandy beach with very safe swimming. In times past, this was a community of fishermen. The village is in two distinct sections, Inner Hope and Outer Hope. The old cottages are given over to holiday lettings. Whilst the village retains its overall quaint, charming character, its inherent past life is lost forever. Inner Hope has the pub and a shop. Outer Hope, with the bigger section of the beach, has quite a number of thatched cottages. A cliff path connects the two. Caught on a fast-dropping ebb tide, there's nothing for it but to sit it out for around 4 or more hours. Of course, there's always the village pub, but what do you do if you've forgotten your anchor? Inland, the area known as South Hams is dotted with farms and little villages. Perhaps this one is where the pig once ruled supreme. The village of East Prawl is not without a sense of humour, particularly the landlord of the village pub, to say nothing of the stores and the cafe. Youngsters are bussed in and out from school. Arriving home in the late afternoon, they behave like youngsters the world over. In a small village like this, no one has secrets. In hidden places on the banks of ancient creeks are old world hostelries, accessible by boat, car, bicycle, or by walking. For many decades, people have made the 1.5 hour trip along the river from Dartmouth to Totnes. Totnes is the navigable limit for larger vessels. Above Dartmouth is the Britannia Royal Naval College. All Royal Naval officers are trained here, one of the best known being the Duke of Edinburgh. As a young teenager, I was brought here. My lasting memories are of the strict discipline and having to swim stark naked in the unheated swimming pool. God, it's cold. So's the sea boy, said the CPO. On the river below are Royal Naval ships and cadet activity. For many years, shipbuilding progressed. Phillips Yard is now closed. Notably, the River Mersey ferries, which still operate, were built here.
But it also has the adverse effect of making them waterlogged.
On the Kingswear side of the river, the crime author Agatha Christie had her home from 1938. The property may be offered to the National Trust. The boat enters Broadstream. This is almost a lake. An egret patrols the bank. The marked anchor stone. In times past, men brought their nagging wives and tied them here to be cooled down by the rising tide. On occasion, the odd one forgot to leave the pub in time. Greenway Cottage. It's said that it was in this house that Sir Walter Raleigh first introduced tobacco and smoking into England. The village of Dittisham has been here for hundreds of years. Famous for its plum orchards, it was the home of Richard Dimbleby, the war correspondent of World War II fame. Entering Longstream, the boat passes Stoke Gabriel, the birthplace of George Jackson Churchward, the famous locomotive designer. In the village churchyard is the oldest yew tree in Great Britain, where it has lived for over 1,000 years. The approach to Totnes is marked in the distance by the ancient church tower. To port is Baltic Wharf. Large ships were able to navigate the river with the tide to this point.
Thank you very much for travelling with us on the Cardiff Castle today. We'll just take this opportunity to wish you a very Merry Christmas and a very happy new year. Thanks very much, folks. Bye-bye.
The very ancient town of Totnes, first settled in pre-Roman times, makes the site over 2,000 years old. It became established as a proper town in the early Saxon period. In many of these ancient English towns, the streets remain narrow with interesting little shops. Ancient town or not, the pressure of 21st century living takes its toll. A feature are the colonnaded rows. There are many old pubs in and around the old towns, some going back hundreds of years. Leaving Dartmouth and the area, people cross on the ferries to Kingswear to let the train take the strain. From the 19th century, as in the 21st, steam trains of the old Great Western Company have brought and taken people from this historic land. The Reverend Sabine Baring Gould, composer of Onward Christian Soldiers, was correct when he said, "Verily, it has scenes that are unrivalled in the whole world."